Thank you for having us, Laura. And I just want to say thank you, Katie, for keep getting us all organized here after a few little hiccups on our side. So it's really great to be back at the University of Michigan. It was about maybe 2 years ago now. We had an exhibition over at Taubman College about some research we were doing in Southeast Asia, supported by the Center for Southeast Asian Studies. And if any of you are here, hi. This young man came into the exhibition and said, "This seems kind of interesting. What are you guys up to?" And Frank and I have been working together for the last few years, so it's really great to be here to both kind of welcome him coming from Michigan with the Fulbright, and also to begin some work with the School of Public Health, who'll be joining us in Jakarta in July to look at some new research on dengue. So I'm just going to set up the framework of the project, a few points of context, and then run through some of the issues, and then Frank will fill out the remainder about some of the more specific technical components. But I just want to say from the beginning, when I say we, I mean myself and Frank and the team at SMART, the engineers that we work with at Twitter, the community organizations in the groups that I'll mention, the University of Wollongong team of engineers that work with us. And so we have quite a large team. And I'll name those folks when I can. But when I say we, I don't mean it in a royal sense. I mean it like we have a really great team. And it's nice to be collaborating across such a multidisciplinary project. So when we say hacking the urban interface, I mean that both quite literally in a way something like this, but also in a broader sense of an approach to the city. So I don't know if any of you have got speeding tickets before, but when you're driving down the freeway, the camera will photograph your license and then license plate, and then it will photograph it a second time. And if the time between those two photographs is a certain ratio, that means you're speeding, right? And it will send you a ticket to the address that's connected to your license plate. Now, if you understand the urban environment as an interaction among sensors, networks, relays, databases, and all that other physical infrastructure, like the road and the bridge and the camera, then you can start to see how you could begin to intervene in some of those processes. So rather than leaving your license plate on the front of the car, you could put an SQL injection over your license plate to drop the table and delete the database so that you wouldn't get a ticket. The legality of that is uncertain. I think it's too innovative to be illegal yet. But of course, this as a kind of hack suggests that there are ways to interact with the back of the scene, the what's happening behind the city, organizing its data and organizing its processes. So hacking the urban interface is a way of approaching the city as not just physical infrastructure, but as the social relationships and the data relationships that are there. Now, unfortunately, though, these cars have led to a few problems. Last year, we celebrated the anniversary of the 1 billionth automobile. I think most of those are in Jakarta. And they have produced a series of issues, climate change not least among them. So just recently in Nature, we found out that this is the first time for anyone in the genus Homo to breathe air with 400 parts per million carbon dioxide. So that's a significant change and a strain that is being felt quite acutely in the tropics already. But what's quite important for us when we think about this question of hack and how the city relates to it is thinking about the problems of scale. So in the Holderlin-Elrich equation for understanding human impact, so human impact as anthropogenic impact as a relationship between population, affluence, and technology. Now, if you look at that in the series of these three trajectories, around 1900, we can get a sense of this relationship of scale from 1900 to 2000. And I put this up because I think it's quite important that a lot of the ways that we approach problems in cities are still coming out of the little box. our disciplines, the way we've divided forms of research and forms of governance, the separation between policy and inquiry. All of these things are kind of holdovers from the scale of the 1900 box, the university, 1817, I think, the University of Michigan. And so when we reach human anthropogenic impact at the scale of the larger box, we have to start understanding that the scale, that scalar implications of that mean that our research cannot maintain those same divisions. And so what we really try to do at the Smart Infrastructure Facility is to use the same tools to study a problem as to intervene in it. So when we're designing the software to collect data, to understand a process, we're already anticipating the implication of that data within the structure that it's studying. How will it change that structure and lead toward climate adaptation? So the area that we call this our Asian circle, the research territory, everything must be able to work within this particular circle. I don't know how many of you have seen this image before. We didn't make it, we just made it look nice. So that's a substantial number of people. We said if we can work at least on half the world's population, that would be a fair target audience. We would have to select out for the megacities, of which there are at least 20 in the circle, and that number is growing every year. So cities over 8 million. And then, of course, 14 of those sitting on deltas, and 18 of them with major issues of flooding in the last decade. Now, of course, we could go into a number of the issues related to flooding, from cost, physical infrastructure damage, lost income, the expense for repairs, and of course, all of the costs in physical health and well-being. For us, the main issue in trying to understand flooding in this context is its effect on these huge, complex urban systems. And so if we take those 20 megacities, there's about, you know, less than 300 million people as a proper counted population. But if we take all of the informal settlements and all of the other residents who are not counted, that's going to total really probably 500 million. So the idea is all of the software that's built has to be able to be transferred to any of those cities for any of the issues there. Whether that's trash, or we'll bring up some of the other domains of application, not just flooding, but that it's also transferable for its tiles, for its GIS, for its language, etc., so that we don't rebuild everything every time. So the pilot study that we are just concluding now took place in Jakarta with the Jakarta Emergency Management Agency, which is acronym BPBD, or BPBD DKI Jakarta. And this was a partnership between ourselves at the Smart Infrastructure Facility, the Jakarta government, and the Emergency Management Service, and then Twitter came on as a partner later on. I'll explain that. So for those of you who have not been, the dark gray is Indonesia. In the call out, the lighter inside of that is the main city of Jakarta. The smaller gray, and then that's the metropolitan area with the Chiliwung, the main river that we'll talk about. That's the watershed running through the middle. That's about 28 million residents in the metropolitan area. I add this one slide just to point out some of the strains of doing multidisciplinary work. So this is a book that I have in my office. And when my colleagues from computer science come into the office, they always pick it up because they think it's a book about programming language. So multidisciplinarity is a challenge for all of us, and you have to understand that for me, when I say Java, I mean the most populated island on Earth, 140 million people. My computer science guys are saying, oh yeah, Java, okay, cool. And it took us about a week to realize we're not talking about the same Java. And then, wow, that's why all those conversations were so strange. But so we have people working from everything from interactive design all the way to GIS, IT architecture, and a number of geomatics folks. So I think it's important to say it's not just the context of intercultural work, but also trying to really push across a number of boundaries. So Jakarta, as you will know, was a colony, the colonial city of Batavia, seen here. And you'll notice that one of the things that the Dutch like to do is to make the swamp lands that they inhabit commodious and beautiful. So they do that by designing canals into the environment, and then in a large way, trying to control the 13 rivers that run through Jakarta. Now, over a longer timeline, the explosion of the city swallows all of that old infrastructure. So what was used to be infrastructure at the edge of the city is now very centralized. So you can see from the Landsat from 1976, this is a bit counterintuitive because the green is hardscape, right? So the red is vegetation. So you see that we really lose all of the vegetation within the metropolitan area. Jakarta, as of 2014, has the highest rate of urbanization in the world, with the metropolitan area having an estimated population of about 28 million, although no one has ever effectively given a precise count. The most precise count was automobiles or motor vehicles, which was 38.7 million during the weekdays. So that's a bit of traffic. That's why Frank flies over everything. So another reason why we focus on Jakarta as a first pilot study is because it's already shown some significant transformations in terms of the tropical monsoon as a result of climate change. So in the image on the left-hand side, or let's start with the image on the right. So you can see along the top of our friend eating lunch here under his little roof, there's a line that says Banjir 2007. That Banjir is the Bahasa Indonesian word for flood. And so he's sitting on a bridge, I think is important to note. So the flood in 2007, an absolutely massive event. Over 40% of the city was inundated, but that occurred once. So the flood comes, goes away, and then everyone returns home. Now, on the image on the left, this is in the same neighborhood, maybe about four blocks away, and this is the sixth time that this gentleman has had to clean up the mud from the flood. This is 2013. So that instead of having one major event of the monsoon building up, a lot of water in the system, overflowing, everyone's displaced, then they come back, the intensity of precipitation means that now there are 6, 7, 8 evacuations per neighborhood per season. So you can imagine the cost of that for the municipal government, as well as the cost of stress and of health for the residents who are constantly being moved out of the way, coming back to try to clean up, and then again displaced. Another reason why Jakarta is an important test case, and this is an image that Frank took from the drone, this is in one of the main locks at an area called Manggarai, and you see that this is the main train station. So the relationship between different types of infrastructure becomes increasingly complicated in these complex urban systems. So that if the main gate, which 40% of the water in Jakarta has to run through here, was to disrupt this, then we would also lose this main east-west corridor as well as the railway. So this question of infrastructure interdependency becomes very important to us. And again, that's not just physical infrastructure, it's all of the other spin-outs that are related to that. So the final reason for Jakarta is that I guess you could say that they are addicted to social media. Yeah, you will agree with me. There is an excitement over social media unprecedented in the world. So Jakarta has the highest number of tweets per capita. They also have one of the highest mobile phone penetration in the world. And so what we thought is if we could get all of these selfies that everyone is taking with their kids in the flood out of the data body of the city, right? So this guy takes the image, tweets it out. If we could get that information and connect it to the area where he is, we would have a real-time flood monitoring system that would be in a number of ways quite quite an improvement on the current situation. So what is the current situation? I'm just going to explain this process called normalization very quickly. I'm going to run through these slides at a pace, but I just want to explain it because I think it's a really important to understand how the flood is being dealt with in the current context. So this is January 2013 at the center of the business district in Jakarta. This is normally a water feature, but normally it ends at the edge of the fountain. Here you can see people are still enjoying it despite the flood around them. And this is what we call an aleatory event. This is as a result of a piece of infrastructure, one of the canal walls washing out, and then the water is simply just filling the downtown. This is the treasury, all of the banks, all of the main business. This tower is Deutsche Bank, seen in the left-hand side. And so I think it's important to understand that this, in the context of hydraulic engineering, these are not the kinds of things you can model, right? You can't say, oh, maybe if the canal wall washes out, then this will happen, and then we will need to do X, Y, and Z. And so one of the main reasons why we are advocating for a much more real-time data collection process is because traditional forms of modeling within hydraulic engineering don't work, because they can't anticipate this. Of course, that doesn't mean these kinds of events can't be recuperated. And the way that they've been recuperated traditionally in Indonesia is to blame them on the urban poor and use that process of blaming and shaming as a way to clear a lot of the informal settlements. So this particular event, although it can clearly be traced to a failure of infrastructure, was blamed on a group of residents in the north of the city, down by the ocean, because allegedly their trash created a clog in the system which flooded the CBD some miles away. As difficult as it would be to believe that story, when images like this circulate in the media as a way of saying, look at these people, look at how they treat the water system, they need to be moved, this is a very significant way of mobilizing the public behind supporting processes of normalization. So normalization involves shearing off the edge of the riverbank where people may have previously been living in informal settlements. Often it involves straightening the river, which is occurring here, and then it includes the introduction of concrete piles to form a solid embankment. So think of the LA River, right, as the outcome of this. Here is installation, here is the final product. I wouldn't say it's elegant by any means, but allegedly this will help reduce the flooding. Now, of course, for even a basic understanding of hydraulic engineering, you would then say, well, if the river can't overflow upstream, everything inside of it, including all of the sediment, will be delivered to the city downstream. So, as we found in the last few years, that means that the amount of really toxic sludge and mud that arrives in the city is increasing quite substantially. Now, if I said all of those 13 rivers were all effectively sewer drains, you would imagine that this substance would be quite toxic. So when residents have to dig out their house under 3 feet of this mud, now again, coming back to the question of climate change and the changing of the monsoon, instead of doing it once, we have to do it 6 times or up to 10 times. Many residents will not agree to be relocated outside of the city during the flood because they want to remain close to the house. This is because if this substance dries and it becomes dust and you get it in your lungs, you will 100% be sent to the hospital. And in many cases, this is a key to understanding morbidity as a result of the flooding. Now, of course, the government doesn't understand it that way. They say, won't these residents just leave? So in order to encourage that, a number of neighborhoods that would typically look something like this, this is an informal settlement in the north. In order to keep those residents from suffering the effects of flooding, their houses are bulldozed. They're replaced by, in this case, an eco park, which is the thing on the left, if it wasn't obvious, and police stations, and they're relocated into housing such as this. Now, of course, this housing, these contracts are quite lucrative because the materials can be skimmed quite easily, and so what we end up with is quite problematic substandard housing. This is 1 year after completion. This is 1 year after completion. So already collapsing within 1 year of residents moving in. Those residents are required to prepay electricity. They're no longer allowed to access water from informal networks of distribution, but must pay large multinationals. And all of the food stalls that were the front of house of many of those residents are removed for the sake of orderliness. So one of the key elements of survival in the informal settlements is what we call incrementality, so that people can build up their house and their livelihood in increments, right? You're not going to buy the whole house at once. There is no access to credit. This is a physical example of that, where you can see that clearly these things have, as we get a little more bricks, we get a little more house. By substituting that for large block settlements, and you can see this doesn't look exactly like a booming settlement here. This is one of the examples that has been abandoned because residents simply cannot make a living pushed so far out of the city in these type of settlements. So they move back alongside the water infrastructure, build new informal settlements, and the process begins all over. Now, in Jakarta, there is an estimated at least 1 million plus residents living in equal informal, unrecognized settlements, and those are typically in places that are the most likely to flood and have the highest risk of injury in that context. So what we're trying to do is say, instead of having this process of this huge expenditure of chasing people around the city effectively to displace them, can we start to integrate the concerns and capacities of the urban poor to actually function as an engine of climate adaptation? So this is our emblematic character. He is the sort of mascot of Peta Jakarta. So we have a few elements of this photo that are important. One is that this flood event has really disrupted the traffic in the city. You cannot cross through on a motorbike or a car. But then a lot of the urban poor will entrepreneurially repurpose their garbage carts to act as shuttles, right? So then you can say, oh, at least I can cross the intersection and keep moving through the city. Now, of course, what's really important about this image is that as residents find ways to cross through the floods, they tell them to each other. So here we have this gentleman tweeting his location, saying, okay, you can cross here, come to this intersection, there's a ferry man here, right? Well, so then everyone's telling each other, this is a good place, oh, there's no ferries here, oh, there's a lineup, etc. Well, we said, if we could actually have understanding of those forms of adaptation and this sort of ingenuity, then we could really start to understand how the process can be both managed and what we say civic co-management as a goal of climate adaptation. So we thought we had this amazing idea. It was really one of the most important nights of my life. We were sitting in the rain in the monsoon and we said, oh my God, what if we just sent all of the people who were talking about flooding a message and told them, tell us what's going on and we'll put it on a map. And so we thought this was the greatest invention that had ever been thought of in the history of computer science. And then we made that thing and turned it on. And then we got a cease and desist order from Twitter 60 seconds later because we had invented spam, which nobody's so into. So that was a bit of a hurdle. But the thing is that, like, there's good spam and bad spam, right? And so we decided to really advocate for this as an idea that we could use an existing platform of social media like Twitter to really increase the reach of data collection, but they would have to allow us to have a little bit more freedom to do so. So working with Sarah Dean, who's a graphic designer at Stamen in the Bay Area in California, and a number of other video artists and interface designers, we came up with a proposal. Let us just have 60 seconds of video, and we will send a message to anyone who's talking about flooding, just a little, hey, is there a flood over there? Like, no, we're not creepy. We're not listening to your Twitter stream. We just wanted to know if anything was going on. And then we would embed this video to invite them. So if their language is English, they will receive the English version. If they're speaking or texting or tweeting in Bahasa Indonesian, they would get the Bahasa Indonesian version. So this is what you would receive. So you sent, hey, Etienne, there's a guy over here you can get across. And then you would get this reply.
There is a new tool in Jakarta bringing together mobile mapping and local flood information. This community flood map is available anywhere, alerting you to water impasses in real time to help you navigate the city. We know that the citizens of Jakarta have the best information on flooding conditions. You are already tweeting each other, helping friends and family avoid hazards around the city. PETA Jakarta uses this on-the-ground information to give you a comprehensive map of the flood conditions. When you see a flood, tweet Banjir at PETA Jakarta and your report will appear on the map, alerting the community to the flood. Remember to turn on your phone's geolocation so we can pinpoint the report. The more people use PETA Jakarta, the better the map will be. Working together, we can help everyone bypass flooded areas, saving time and avoiding danger. Visit petajakarta.org to get started.
So now you can imagine trying to convince the graphic design people that they don't, that this is enough, right? They're like, no, we can make all the, no. No, no. 60 seconds, as light as possible, as little, only what is necessary. And then we show it to the government and they say, well, we know more than the residents where the flood is. Don't, we can't have it say that on there. And it's like, no, no. We're going to say that we're going to valorize the knowledge of the community and we're going to encourage them to participate. We're not going to, and so, you know, there are some hurdles in building such a thing. This is just a simple diagram. If your geolocation is not on, you'd get a second message asking you to geolocate your situation. So you come to an area in the city, you can't get across, you send your message. And there are basically the software splits in two so that if you're accessing from a mobile device, it zooms you into where you're standing in the city. So it's the information most immediately relevant to you. But you can zoom that back out, scale right out to the district level so that from the government side, if they're looking at it in the desktop of their incident control room, they can get a much better top overview. So this is the kind of information people are sending. I use this one because it's an orangutan, as you can see, even they can use it. And so we get this sort of information report. Okay, this is the situation. This is the street area. Things get a little bit more intense as the flood situation continues. So here, if all they need to do is say at PETAJKT, hashtag Banjir, and we pick it up from the API. So here, why don't you guys turn up the pumps, you know, like this specific infrastructure request, like let's get the pumps going, we're a little bit underwater. So working with the emergency management agency then, this is coordinated so that we're looking at that information alongside their more traditional forms of data gathering. So this is what the map kind of looks like, and we really pushed to develop this as quickly and lightly as possible. And then we managed to convince the Jakarta government to endorse it. So that was quite helpful. Here's the governor of Jakarta, and we got him to send the first tweet to the president, you know? So it's like, yo, bro, and you can't find your way around, you know, tweet this thing up. Didn't get a retweet, but, you know. Next year. So the government side, they're looking at the situation something like this. So this is a flood-affected area map. You can see 1800, so these are produced every 6 hours, and all of these little shapes, these polygons are RW districts. It's the second smallest political boundary level. And so the red are, of course, the most affected, down to the white here. So this isn't a terrible flooding day. But what we're trying to do is build the system so that that can run exactly in parallel with the same polygons, so that we can have a very simple mode of introduction of the social media information. So we aggregate the tweets at the district level, but that we can then drill down through that to see which of these is the affected area, and then open those tweets up. Over the next 6 months, all of this will be embedded as well, but can only go as fast as you can go. And then in addition to that, a spatial topological network model connecting all of the infrastructure and the pumps and gates, so that we have an overview of the situation, so that as you see an area affected, you can drill down, confirm that, and then begin to actually make decisions for, do we close a gate, do we open a lock, do we turn up a pump? And so in the joint pilot study, we had 1,000, what we say, confirmed reports, which are high quality, specific information that's actually useful. There was really 4 days of bad flooding this year compared to maybe 21 last year. And so it's important to try to keep that momentum going and not allow that to produce a certain complacency. And so that's integrated into the control room, or the incident control room at the Jakarta Emergency Management Agency, where now we can begin to link together a series of APIs, including the Twitter one and other emergency services, so that we can have a decision support tool that's actually effective for managing this information. So that decision support tool is called Cognicity. Please check it out if that's the kind of stuff that you're working on. That's just a basic website, but it's also on GitHub. You can see it's basically a very simple way of trying to take urban data and push it to a map so that we can have both communicating that information and analyzing it in a spatial way. So very simple. Again, it's critical that that's both publicly available through a mobile device, but that can also be seen at a more top-level view. Hurry up through this, but. So we managed to get, after our little tiff with Twitter, we managed to get a data grant, which for those of you working, whether in epidemiology or other areas, keep an eye on those because they can be very interesting material. So by looking at the relationship between the location of the tweets and the flood-affected area maps, we start to get a very good idea of the event triggers within the system. This is just to give you a sense of the spread. So that's about 12 million tweets from 2013-14. That's the city limits of Jakarta. So you can start to see some of the main arterial roadways. And this little white spot on the edge, anyone have a guess what that is? Military base, right? No, you don't tweet at the military base. But this also, I think, is important to show because it's suggestive of the heterogeneity of Jakarta. So a lot of people say, well, don't just rich people have, like, rich people on their smartphones are sending tweets, everyone else is sending SMS. But because of the heterogeneity of the city and the interaction of different kinds of people with the flood, we end up getting a really good overall picture, even though everyone doesn't have a smartphone. But that would be insufficient if we weren't also doing community-led data collection in the informal settlements as well. So one part of that is integrated planning, and I'll give you the explanation of this pretty quickly. Residents have been working together, and this has been a long-term project in each slum, where they will take this sort of rope lines and string them along the buildings, right? So that if the flood comes at night and you have to be evacuated at night, first thing you want to do if that happens is kill the electricity. So I don't know how many of you have been in water up to your head in the dark, but it's helpful to have something to follow your way out. Now, also, in some instances, the current can be quite strong. So while, you know, some days the flood looks quite like everyone's just kind of swimming around, by nighttime with a strong current, that's quite a terrifying situation. So these rope lines are installed as a way to community-led preparedness, anticipating the flood, and then the government wants to come in and help these people, rescue them. Now, you'll notice there is a material conflict here. The rope lines made of nylon and the propeller on the motor do not interact well together, in that one cuts the other in half. So people are trying to pull themselves out to get to the rescue boat on a rope line that's been cut by the boat that's there to rescue them. That's not progress, right? So we said, and especially as this as just such a the best efforts and the best intentions of both groups canceling each other out. So we said, why don't we just start to map some of these rope lines, integrate that into the planning, feed that back in the community and say, is this the best way to be evacuating? And then the key thing is to get that spatial data back into the system so that the government then is responding in a way that's actually useful. Now, that's pre-event. Post-event, we also want to understand the impact on these communities. And this is something where I think maybe some of you folks might be kind of interested. So we've been piloting ways of doing really rapid data collection, a geospatial rapid assessment survey platform plugged into Twitter, so we can see that these residents, House 52, 5 residents, 15 days off work, 1.5 million rupiah lost, 45 days off school for the kids, 30 total sick days in the house, 220,000 rupiah of damage, and the flood is at shoulder height. Now, these are this is a test. This is showing that this can be done effectively. This will scale quite dramatically in the next few months when I get back to Jakarta. But just to give you a sense, we can really start to understand the relationship of the flood to economic loss. And if we plug that into some of the local maps that are made by the residents and georectify them, we can start to understand that in a spatial way, so that when the government says, we want to evict you, the relationship between the community can say, well, we've studied the process, we realize that some of these houses should be moved back or removed, but the rest of the community should stay. So that's a process of returning that data into the kampong, presenting it back to the residents who helped collect it, and then trying to make an argument together about how the best process of adaptation and potentially of relocation will occur. So you recall those images of the trash that I showed you that led to this whole normalization process. Frank's ready to go now. So we've been working with a group called Chiliwang Institute and this really great group of activists mapping some of these things in Jakarta, because we said, well, it's one thing to try to fight the process at the bottom, but what about all of that trash? I think Frank might be in this boat or in the one behind. So we started to look for, where does all this garbage come from? If these people are so poor, how do they make so much garbage? Seems a strange coincidence, no? And so we started to locate a number of these illegal dumps. And they started to appear more and more. And the more we went down different rivers, the more we found illegal dumps. But unfortunately, just regular people like us, we're working with local activists, those reports tend to go somewhat on deaf ears. So we had to bring in the big M and stick it on a drone, and then I'll turn it over to Frank to explain why the drone will get the job done where we in the boat simply could not.
Thank you, Etienne. I'm gonna switch over. Just right there, cool. Let's talk garbage here. Before I begin, I would like to thank Mr. Essel Bailey for providing a grant to kind of get this project going on my behalf here last summer. So as Etienne mentioned, you know, huge amount of garbage in Jakarta, but where is it coming from? How does it vary in time and space? You know, all these these questions on garbage, and there's, you know, as we started to look into it, there's zero data available on the government's behalf. There is one bit, however. This is photos taken at the very north part of Jakarta, right before the rivers drain into the ocean. And the only bit of information I could get on the total amount of garbage was, well, if it's not flooding, we get we haul away four of these dump trucks worth of trash every day. If it is flooding, seven dump trucks a day. And mind you, this is from the very end of kind of the whole river system. You know, you have no clue where it's coming along, or where the garbage is being thrown into the river, by what communities. Is it residential? Is it industrial? Massive kind of lapse in data. And so this is what we kind of sought to begin getting a grasp on. So obviously garbage is, you know, quite a few bad things about it. From our initial perspective, right, garbage causes a lot of problems for flooding when it's thrown in the rivers. These are a few pictures of pipes clogged with who knows what, but you know, I can tell you that water does not really flow through that too well. You get a lot of pumps oftentimes break because trash gets clogged in the impellers. You have flood reservoirs that have lost half their volume because, you know, there's just 3 meters of garbage on the bottom. And then for you folks here, you know, you can imagine the health effects from all this garbage. And with this research that I'm working on, you know, I'm only looking at solid waste right now, but, you know, from hanging around these rivers and, you know, swimming in them now and then, I can tell you, you know, there's quite a bit of liquid waste as well. So so here we see, this is one of the communities that we've been kind of focusing a lot of our efforts on, well, Bukit Duri in central Jakarta. And you can see here, I mean, just how many people are situated along on either side of this main river here, the Chiliwung River. And the key thing, though, to notice of how these kampungs, these neighborhoods in Jakarta interact with the river is through these kind of platforms that you see jutting out into the river here. Now, these platforms are a very, you know, multi-purpose thing. It's basically a few sheets of bamboo lashed together. And on the front of the platforms, you know, that's where you brush your teeth, wash your pots and pans, do your laundry, you know, jump in for a swim, which is, you know, nice and refreshing. But the only problem is maybe 20 feet downstream you have the outhouses. And, you know, so you jump in, you kind of get washed down river, and, you know, you wave to the person, you know, using the toilet as you go by. So, you know, this is the issue with the trash in Jakarta. I mean, people live and interact with it at a very close level. And so to give you a sense of how much garbage we're talking about, this is a quick time lapse over a couple hours of a camera I put in a tree. And you just see the basically never-ending flow of garbage going by. And this goes on all hours of the day, night, day, you know, it doesn't matter. When you look at it, you'll see this amount of garbage. It's kind of fun looking at it, you know, picking up things like a mattress floating by or some guy in a tire tube, you know, lazy rivering it. So this huge amount of garbage, but as Etienne mentioned, you know, that's a lot of garbage for some very, very poor marginalized people. You know, surely they can't be producing all of this garbage. And it turns out they're not. So some initial mappings that we did around this kind of area of this Kampung Bukit Duri in central Jakarta, you know, in a couple of kilometers in either direction, upstream and downstream of this neighborhood, through a mixture of flying the drone, talking with communities, and just basically rafting down the river, we've detected about 12 illegal garbage dumps shown here in these red dots. And those garbage dumps, well, they are still utilized by the residents themselves. The residents most often just toss the garbage out their back door. These garbage dumps are a bit more organized. They're kind of hidden from the road. You can't see them unless you really know where you're going. And if you just kind of hang out by one for a bit, this is how I spend my summers, is hanging out by garbage dumps. You see these big trucks coming just to dump basically industrial waste into these locations. So, you know, from these initial findings, you know, it's pretty obvious, at least to us, that it's not the residents. It's a bit more organized, a bit more commercialized garbage dumping. And just to give you a kind of a sense of up close here, this is, you know, rafting down from one of these garbage dumps And you just see the extent of garbage lining, you know, the trees and the banks and basically every bit of these neighborhoods here. And so what we're doing, you know, we thought, you know, we know that this is clearly not, the garbage is not from the residents, it's being produced otherwise. How do we convince the government and how do we provide some hard data on where the garbage is coming from? How much garbage is each neighborhood producing? And so again, with funding that the Baileys helped me with here, I've been installing a number of time-lapse cameras throughout kind of central Jakarta, a couple neighborhoods, typically installing over a bridge if I can from an overhanging tree branch, you know, working with the residents to find a suitable place. And so they're not really freaked out by this tall, you know, Dutch-looking fellow coming back with cameras, right? So here we're installing a camera above a bridge. And I'll leave these cameras, you know, for a couple of weeks at a time, collect a lot of photos, maybe take a photo every 3 seconds. And with all those photos then, what I'm doing is to generate, you know, statistics on how much garbage each neighborhood is producing, developing some algorithms pretty similar to, you know, if you take out your cell phone, take a picture of someone, it detects someone's face, right? How does your computer or your cell phone know to detect a face, know that that's a face? It's a class of computer vision algorithms known as basically object detection. So, you know, we're building these algorithms that function much the same way, basically. This is a test from a lab up on North Campus. But the idea is such. If you have a bunch of objects, in this example, ping pong balls, floating down the river, how do you get the camera to detect them? And in the process of detecting them, you can see here with the yellow box, you know, beginning a tally of the amount of garbage detected. And so with this information then, we can basically bracket each neighborhood and say between point A and point B, this neighborhood threw in, you know, 500 pieces of garbage or 50 pieces of garbage. And, you know, we can begin comparing this to the garbage dumps upstream that, you know, I can assure you, are producing a lot more garbage than these neighborhoods. So this is what the camera sees. This is the Space Invaders version here. This is what the computer actually sees as it's going through the detection itself. Little issues, some glare here and there that we're ironing out. But and with this data then, again, since we're big on the whole community participation, how do we begin incorporating this into the existing maps of Petit Jakarta and getting people to start tweeting locations of garbage and, you know, when you see observed spikes in the garbage in the rivers and begin kind of formalizing the process of garbage management, garbage detection, which hopefully will lead to, I guess, a bit more just processes of eviction. You know, the government can't kind of toss around these claims that the poor people are throwing the garbage and that they're solely responsible for the garbage. So that's, again, tying into the existing Petit Jakarta framework. And the second thing we're really beginning to pioneer is, well, the use of drones. At Petit Jakarta, we, again, started off with Twitter, but really there's all these different kind of urban sensors that you can incorporate in much the same way into the existing framework. So do you want to give a quick introduction to this, Etienne?
Just add a really quick point here that I think is really important about why all of these things, like, in the same way, you can't talk about flooding if you're not going to talk about waste management. We can't just use social media and map that. The array of sensors and potential for crowdsourcing and collaborative research is quite substantial. And I offer this example as one that I think many of you will know, but you may not realize how important it is. So that's January 12, 2010 in Port-au-Prince in Haiti after the earthquake, one of the most devastating events in the Western Hemisphere recently. 230,000 residents die immediately. That's maybe about a week later. And so what you have is a situation where no one has any information. There is no spatial data available of any kind to coordinate what kind of response would be required to address a tragedy of this magnitude. So how many of you have heard of Ushahidi? Yes. So Ushahidi is a project that came out of Kenya. It's a crowdsourcing platform that was designed to report acts of violence around the elections in Kenya. And then it kind of grew from there and got some substantial support through a number of donors. And then that platform was produced as an open source platform that anyone could use to crowdsource information about any situation, right? Not just election scenarios. So Patrick Meyer at Tufts in Boston takes that platform and says, we'll use this to plug in everything we know about Haiti. Someone needs to start coordinating this. So how do we get from those people who are in need to send a message to process all of that data, organize everything in a way that can then be used to drive the response? This is the map of Port-au-Prince on January 10th, the day of the earthquake. Working with Microsoft Bing, Patrick managed to get them to release their satellite images so that then a group of dispersed activists, over 500 people working remotely, could trace out the effects of the earthquake and then integrate them into the map. This is a process that was so effective that the Ushahidi platform was managing the US Marine response. The Marines could not organize this information to get this coordinated. So I think it's showing the significance of a grassroots, bottom-up structure for managing these kinds of events. Of course, they require the resources of the Marines, but the logic of crowdsourcing is quite important. Now, the difference in Jakarta and why the drones have been brought into the project, primary reason, is that a concept from Rob Nixon called slow violence. So in Haiti, there's a huge tragedy, and everyone says, oh, you can have our satellite data for free, and oh, we can help you with these things. In Jakarta, there is no huge tragedy that can mobilize that kind of donor experience. And so what we have to do is find ways to integrate information for planning so that we don't end up in that kind of scenario. And so this is where I think it's quite interesting. How do we begin to mobilize new forms of data collection that can stand in for the kind of satellite and LIDAR scanning that we simply can't access? And so I'll turn it back over to Frank. But for those of you interested in that kind of crowdsourcing, Ushahidi is definitely a project to look at. Oh, yeah. Wow. Here it goes then.
So picking up there, with this kind of idea of, you know, there's maps just don't exist for an area. This is, again, a very poor kampung, a very informal, we'll call it slum, basically, in, again, northern Jakarta. This white area up here zoomed in here. And using free existing imagery or data, this is the best we have from Google Earth. You know, you can barely even make out what houses are there, much less, you know, any walkways or anything else. And as Etienne mentioned, you know, this is very, having proper maps of these unmapped areas is very important for flooding, especially for evacuation routes, for directing relief supplies, you know, coordinating safe passage through these streets. Now, the best maps that exist of this area, Kampung Bukaduri is its name, come in the form of basically hand-drawn maps by activists. This is one such map, basically walking every single street in this kampung, which in this case isn't a bad thing. It's only about two streets, but, you know, scale it up a bit and you've got quite a big problem on your hands. And the interesting thing with these kampungs in Jakarta, not just Jakarta, but really any of these informal settlements in Southeast Asia and Africa, is they're very transient. They change a lot. Roads that were there maybe a few months ago, you know, gone the next month. So you need imagery, you need data that you can constantly be updating basically whenever you need to. And if you go the kind of traditional way with satellite imagery, for about 1 square kilometer of pretty good resolution satellite, you know, you're looking at a couple $1,000s. And again, that's not really on demand. The cost is quite prohibitive. So, you know, what are the other options? And, you know, it turns out those other options are drones. This is actually the first, well, you've heard a lot about drones in recent years. It's kind of a big thing right now, but it turns out drones are over 100 years old. This is the, we'll call it the first drone ever. This is a part of the Bavarian Pigeon Corps in World War I. A pigeon camera on its chest, fly over the enemy lines, and good luck, buddy. So, 100 years later, it's, for better or for worse, it's the same kind of concept here. So, this is kind of pigeon 2.0 here. So, what I'm holding here, this is one of the more popular drones on the market today, a DJI Phantom 2. And for just under $1,000, actually, since I've made these slides, the price has dropped about $200 now for this system. You can get this drone, four propellers, dead simple to control. If I'm not going to fly it in here, just for safety reasons, but if you're out in a nice open field, you can basically set it down, pull out your cell phone, draw a few zigzags for the flight path, hit takeoff, it'll go do its thing. Grab a cup of coffee, come back, it'll land itself. It's incredibly powerful for, at this point, well under $1,000. Add to this, then, to, of course, collect the imagery, just, a small GoPro camera. This is a Hero 3, quite small, quite portable. And you attach it to this gimbal here, which keeps it stable during flight. Now, with this system, we run these kind of these specialized batteries. Just lithium ion things here. And one battery gives you about 20 minutes of flight time. Again, pretty substantial. I've never actually run out of battery before. It's usually, I've filmed everything I need to. And so with this system, under $1,500, 20 minutes of flight time, you can cover about 2 square kilometers pretty thoroughly with imagery. This is, very, you look down and say, "Hi, Mom, I see you," from a couple hundred feet above. It's great imagery. It's very high detail. It's better than satellite often. And again, we can do this, in the time it basically takes us to get out to the site that we need the imagery. In our case, this campling in North Jakarta that's facing eviction for the second time in about as many years. So before I kind of continue on discussing Kampung Bukitduri or Kampung Bodhidharma, again, getting back to this idea of civic co-management, how do we begin leveraging the power of drones, not just from me or from the government, but really the rest of the residents of Jakarta in our case? There's a ton of drones already in Jakarta, but most of them are being used for drone selfies. I'm guilty of that as well. Great Facebook profile picture. But how do we begin leveraging this very, very powerful tool again? Much in the same way Twitter kind of has its faced the same problem. How do we move beyond a selfie? I think the most tweeted tweet in the history of Twitter is a selfie at the Oscars, right? How do you, again, move beyond this? So in Jakarta's case, I just did a quick back of the envelope calculation of what it would really take to cover Jakarta with basically a drone, cover the entire area with a drone, the same drone, 2 square kilometer radius. How many people would that take? So in Jakarta, you have, in the proper district, just about over 10 million people. Pretty sizable area. But even this very, very large city, one of the larger footprints in the world as far as cities go, it would take under 400 drones to basically cover the entire city, hypothetically, with a drone wherever you need it, whenever you need it. And this might seem like a lot of drones, but I purchased this drone actually in Jakarta, and it took me about 3 weeks to buy this drone because a shipment would come in every week, and within 2 hours, every drone would be off the shelf. So, 3 weeks later, and a few bad Indonesian words, and I got this bad boy. So what I'm trying to say, though, is, there's this many drones in Jakarta already, right? How do we kind of leverage this existing platforms that are owned by the citizens? And an important thing, and this is kind of the whole ethos of the civic co-management, is it's not going to be, one government official with a $50,000 drone. It's going to be 50 citizens with, $1,000 drones. Just much more, basically much more resilient. You can much more spread out with as far as where they're located. And the other important thing is, unfortunately, you know, these drones are not a perfect system. Accidents do happen, as we see here. I should have realized red lights are not a good thing to take off with, but lesson learned. These drones, of course, do crash. And I can assure you from personal experience, when a drone like this crashes, I'm the only one losing sleep. If a $50,000 drone crashes that's owned by the city of Jakarta, you know, someone's that's a pretty serious problem. So civic crowdsourced drones, this is what we believe at PETA Jakarta is kind of the way forward with this. So this is when I returned to Jakarta on the Fulbright, this is one of the things we'll be really pushing for is how do we leverage hobbyist drone flyers to engage and to kind of send us their data that's otherwise just sitting on their hard drive, incorporate that into PETA Jakarta, and begin mapping some of these areas that don't have maps already. And so we'll go back to Bodhidharma here. This is some quick imagery that I, from this very same drone that we took of the area. And again, the idea is that maps don't exist for this area. How can we generate the data we need? What can we get out of these drones? So think back to the first pictures of this area you saw on Google Maps. Just, you couldn't even make out any details here. I mean, look how detailed this is. This is all geo-rectified. It's got precise GPS and height locations to it. The kids of the community love this. It's a very good way. People become engaged with the maps that we're working with them to build. And from this data then, I don't have an example with me, but there's some pretty powerful software that exists to basically take this imagery and put it into a nice GIS map format. You basically have a very high resolution map that you've just made in 20 minutes from flying this drone. Safe landing this time. So with these drones, and you know, to be fair, they're, you know, still fairly expensive. I mean, each community is not going to have their own personal drone, but how do we kind of go in with the specialized piece of equipment, and not just us, but other citizens, generate this data, and then hand these built, polished maps off to the community. So the community can then themselves kind of populate these maps with where do people go to work, how many people live in each house, what are the most flood-prone houses. So when you make a case to the government of why these people should be allowed to stay here, you have a very legitimized map of an otherwise unknown, unmapped area with which to make the case. Well, we can do live flight demos out in this courtyard back here afterwards if anyone's interested. Drone selfies for all, I assure you. So with that, I'll let Etienne close up here take some questions.
So I think we can just kind of almost wrap it there. I would just add that I think we're really excited now since Laura contacted me, and we've been working out how to bring into this research project some issues about public health, the dynamics of tropical diseases as they change as a result of climate change, how to test out cognicity to do some other kinds of research. But again, one of the things that I think is really important in the context of this kind of work is integrating those processes into a kind of, not total work, but integrated project. So when Frank comes out with the drone and we want everyone to come and map with us and do the survey, it's a really helpful announcement that we have arrived. You know, the drone goes up, the kids go crazy, everyone comes out, everyone gets a selfie, and then we start integrating that process so that the spectacle of our data collection is actually an engine to do even better data collection. And so I think that rather than sending the drone guy and then the health people and then the sociologist, that we work in a much more dynamic and collaborative environment. And even though some days that means we have an hour-long conversation about Java and we both are talking about something else, that in the end that's actually a really productive way of pursuing this kind of research for climate adaptation. Reducing the redundancy of studying and then trying to solve and trying to build the tools that will allow for civic co-management as a way of studying the process itself. So thank you so much for having us.
Thank you.
problems. It's really complications from garbage that's clogging these flood canals and flood reservoirs. All these issues kind of come together to create some very, very intense flooding, which for a civil engineer, this is awesome.